Hey, I'm Jay Royster, and today we are at the Avenues at Atherton, developed by Abacus Capital. We're meeting with managing partner Wes McAdams, and he's going to tell us all about it. So let's go take a look.
Here we go.
So here we are at the Avenues at Atherton, a retail redevelopment by Abacus Capital. Wes, thanks for having us today.
Jay, thanks for inviting me.
So before we get into talking about this deal, if you could, Wes, give us a little bit of background on yourself and your background in commercial real estate.
Sure. So I've been in the real estate industry since I graduated college. Spent a brief stint as a lender to multifamily investors and developers before I then moved over to the investing principal side of the business, where I worked for a large cap private equity fund, went back to business school during the great financial crisis, and then became an investment banker after business school for a stint of time, and then I got back onto the investing side of the business, and most recently I was a principal at a large office and industrial investor and developer here in Charlotte before I started Abacus.
Great. So let's talk about this deal. When you all purchased this a couple of years ago, at the time, it was a main and main location, but I think even now it looks way different today than it did a couple of years ago, primarily with what you've done here, but obviously Edens at Atherton Mill, the apartments and multifamily side with Crescent partnering with Edens. But what led you all to this opportunity and what did you see in this deal a couple of years ago? Today, it's really solidified as a main and main location.
Sure. Well, at Abacus, we pride ourselves on trying to see opportunity where others may see, you know, challenge. And if you can believe it or not, this deal sat on the market for a number of months before we came along and figured out how to unlock, you know, the opportunity that was inherent within the asset. You know, only back in 2018, this wasn't considered as much of a main and main core location as it is today. Obviously, today it's a tower site. There are a number of tower cranes and, you know, 10 to 15, even 20 story buildings being built within a 9-iron of this location. But back in 2018, when we were putting this deal together, Atherton Mill and Market was still in redevelopment. Crescent hadn't delivered their apartments, and Asana in the design district was still leasing up and coming online. And our thesis was, look, you know, you've got these two really dynamic sort of live, work, play locations with design district and Atherton Market that are charging very premium rents. And, you know, we could make this deal work at rents that really had never been seen before in South End or in Charlotte, but still at a discount to the rents that were being achieved across the street. So we thought this deal worked at 75 to 80% of the rents across the street. Lo and behold, we redeveloped it. They got full. We started getting the same rents as them. And in some cases, I think a few of our tenants are even maybe paying higher rents than they're achieving across the street.
Right, yeah, well, kudos to you for having the foresight. Again, it feels way different today. It's only been a couple of years, but it's been a dramatic difference. And it's interesting you bring up the towers that are going on in South End across the street, because a lot of the big block redevelopment has happened on the light rail side, as opposed to the Dilworth side. This is located on the Dilworth side. I think one of the benefits of that is you're on the AM going into town, but again, a lot of the major redevelopment has happened on the South End light rail side of South Boulevard, but was there any consideration given to that?
Well, it's funny you mentioned that. That's actually probably why this asset sat on the market so long when we were able to buy it. We call it a fractured sale process. It was being marketed primarily to multifamily developers. And I'm aware of at least one that had control of the site before we ultimately put it under contract and executed on it, that had plans to put a 10 plus story multifamily tower here. And I think as they got into their diligence, they realized that this particular site backs up to single family, the Dilworth Historic neighborhood. And if they were able to get, you know, a tower entitled, it would, you know, be quite challenging, say the least. So we figured out how to turn, you know, this 30,000 square foot, you know, former showroom retail asset into what we call high street retail. The biggest challenge was the parking. There were only 66 physical spaces on site. In order to re-tenant a building like this under the Charlotte's zoning code, you need to have a certain number of parks depending on the type of use. Food and beverage requires 13 parks per 1,000 square feet. General retail requires 4 parks per square feet. We would need over 100 parking spaces in order to re-tenant this building with a very strategic mix of uses across the 31,000 square feet. Fortunately, we figured out how to use the zoning code and turn 66 physical spaces into 125 effective spaces for leasing purposes, which has enabled us to lease the project up.
And so did you rezone this?
Funny you should ask that. As a matter of fact, we didn't rezone this. It chalked us up to dumb luck. Mid business plan execution, the city came along and administratively rezoned this site, as they did, I think, 1,900 different parcels around the city along the light rail. So that solved any sort of residual parking considerations that we needed to factor into our lease up here. So now we're TOD, we have no parking requirements, which is a dramatic change from what we had to deal with as we were putting this deal together.
Yeah, absolutely. So talking about what this was before, in my opinion, it was a pretty underutilized asset. It was only 38% leased, I believe. So how did you all approach redeveloping this, and what did you see in it being so underutilized? Where did you see the opportunity in that as opposed to maybe what others saw?
Now, if this asset had been 60% leased with any amount of lease term, we wouldn't have been able to pay what we paid. We paid $237 a square foot for effectively, you mentioned 38% leased. A number of the tenants were on month-to-month leases because it was being marketed as a development site. The seller didn't want to put fresh term on any of those tenants' leases, and they were paying, you know, $13 to $17 triple net. Now we're striking well into the 40s.
Wow.
So 250 to 300% higher rents. We were actually drawn to the fact that there wasn't any lease term on the rent roll at the time that we bought it, because it allowed us to empty the building out, which we had to do in order to do the redevelopment, and then re-tenant it at post-redeveloped sort of market rates, which have only, you know, moved in our favor since this project was initially conceived.
Yeah, absolutely. So tell us about this space that we're sitting in here. This is one of the biggest blocks that you have left, and I think there's going to be a lot of appetite for this space, but tell us what the plan is for where we're sitting and maybe what it was before.
Sure, Jay. So this is a really interesting, you know, part of our business plan. One of the problems with redeveloping the site into, you know, an economically viable 31,000 square foot, you know, high street retail strip center was that about 6,500 square feet of the building was in this space that actually faces the Dilworth neighborhood, one of the highest demographic and most affluent neighborhoods within Charlotte, but doesn't face the 30,000 cars per day that go down South Boulevard. And further, this portion of the building was built in the 1950s, and the building was added onto a few times subsequently, but this portion of the building was actually an auto repair shop early in its, I guess, at its inception. And the floor to ceiling heights here were only 8 feet, because the grease monkeys would sit down here, and then there were openings in the floor where they would then get on the ladder and work on the underside of the car. So part of our business plan was lowering the floor in this rear facing, we call it the plaza suites, 3.5 feet. So now we've got fully functional, 12-foot ceiling heights. We've had a lot of exciting tenant interest on this space, you know, coming out of the pandemic as the world has been reopening and the vaccine rollout has, you know, really accelerated. And, you know, knock on wood, with any luck here, pretty soon we should have a really exciting food and beverage user that will take the space and create something special for the Dilworth and South End neighborhoods.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, again, I'm very personally, maybe a little selfishly, very excited there for what this space could be, and a big fan of the area, obviously, and you've got Dilworth Tasting Room right across the street, so this is a really dynamic location. So let's zoom out from this project for a minute and talk a little bit more macro for Abacus. You all have really been on an investment tear since you all started, since you branched off and formed your company, but you've got East Boulevard retail, you have Class A office on East Moorhead, you have adaptive reuse in several submarkets around Charlotte, the Freight District, acquisition and development there with Ray Ward. You've got multifamily in South End on Toomey. You all are executing across product types and have a very differentiated and unique outlook to investing, but what gives you the conviction to execute on these complex deals?
Sure. At Abacus, we consider ourselves multi-strategy tactical real estate investors, which is to say that we pursue a diversified subset of product types and investment strategies, but in a very finite number of, you know, markets. We've been in the business 36 months. Over the past 30 months, we've been deploying capital. We've made a dozen investments. 3/4 of those are in the Charlotte market. Currently have a small portfolio in the Triangle market as well. We own a little over 500,000 square feet to date. And, you know, total gross assets under management, right around $200 million at this point. Most recently, we've been focusing a lot around the institutionalization of creative office coming out of the pandemic. We feel like creative office, and specifically adaptively reused legacy warehouse and industrial assets located in urban and infill locations, will be especially favored by, you know, space occupiers seeking a post-pandemic or pandemic-responsive office environment. We have $150 million of that type of development underway, both in Charlotte's Freight District and then in Charlotte's South End. We have five of those buildings going on at various stages of pre-development, redevelopment, or, you know, approaching delivery at this point.
Yeah, well, it sounds like you have a full pipeline and enough to keep you busy for the foreseeable future, but is there anything else kind of moving forward, new pursuits or anything that you're looking
sure.
for on the
I should mention, when I say that we have $150 million in production, that includes a multifamily project that we were able to bolt on to one of these adaptive reuse creative commercial conversion projects where we were able to unlock some otherwise inefficient to develop land
right.
because we owned an asset that was, for lack of a better word, the hole in the middle of the donut.
Right.
So we were able to put some surface parked multifamily in it, what is otherwise a structure parked multifamily market, and really deliver value-oriented product, which we think works at, you know, this point in the business cycle.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thanks for having us today, Wes, and really impressive what you all are doing here, and look forward to continued success for Abacus and everything you guys are doing in Charlotte, and very excited for what you're doing.
Well, Jay, thank you. It's been a pleasure to, you know, talk a little bit about, you know, this project in particular and our young business in general.
Thanks for watching today. If you're interested in keeping up with the latest developments in Charlotte, make sure to like and subscribe.